Good morning. Bonjour tout le monde et bienvenue à St. Andrews. My name is Nancy, and I want to offer a very warm welcome to all of those of you who are here and all of those who are joining us online. Nous sommes heureux d'être ensemble encore. We are grateful to be able to worship on this unceded land cared for by the Algonquin Anishinaabe people long before our church was built. The Tuesday Noon Hour Music as Sanctuary Concert series resumes this Tuesday, featuring Duo Pergulai with organists Francine Nguyen-Savaria and Mathieu Latre, who will perform pieces written for four hands and 4 feet. After the concert, enjoy a delicious homemade soup lunch. The list of all the performers in the coming months is on our St. Andrews website. This Friday, January 19th, you're invited to join us for a movie at the Bytown Theater on Rideau Street with a talk film, talk faith, I'm going to call it an after party, at the home of Andrew Johnston. The RSVP information is in the bulletin. And Friday, January 26th is a big day. First of all, we're hosting a PA day camp. Children from junior kindergarten to grade 5 are invited to a day of free programming at St. Andrews. We also look forward to welcoming children from the Cambridge Street Public School, as well as those already connected to the church. This is going to be a fun-filled day of faith and friendship. Please take a handout and invite any neighbors you may have. We are also looking for youth volunteers to assist in leading the younger children and adults to help with activities and cleanup. Please consider offering your time for part or all of the day to help build relationships within our community and each other. Please speak to Reverend Heather if you are interested. And that same evening, Knox is hosting the Burn Supper. Tickets are on sale after the service. And February 5th, we will celebrate the grand opening of the new nursery. For details of these and other events, please see the bulletin. And if you would like to receive the bulletin electronically, please get in touch with the church office. For those of you who are here, please join us for coffee, tea, and cookies after the service through these doors to my right. Now, would you please rise as you are able for the entry of the Holy Scriptures and the singing of the first hymn, which is 592.
Lord be with you. God is here, and God is calling, and we are here, and can you listen? We come this morning daring to believe, not just that God has a word for us, but that we can hear it and understand it, and we can follow in Jesus' name. So as we gather, let us be still. Let go of the worries and preoccupations of this week. The things you are sure of or unsure of, be still and come and see what God has to show us, what God has to say to us this day. Please be seated. Please pray with me. You have spoken your summons, God, and here we are, stilling ourselves in your presence, you who made us, trusting in Jesus, who is you come among us, seeking to discern the movement of your Spirit, desiring to know you and your will more fully. You have spoken, and here we are. Down through the ages, we remember that you have never stopped seeking us out. You have placed within us a desire for mercy and compassion, justice and kindness. Since the very beginning, you have been drawing us into your embrace, inviting us into your work. And we come today confessing that we have not always heard your voice or listened to what you've said. You have called us to be a light in our living, a sign of your kingdom, offering hope for the world. But sometimes we have been preoccupied with other things. Sometimes we have fallen back on the things we are sure of or unsure of, and fear and anxiety have got in the way. Your expectations are high and holy, God, and we have succumbed to options that are easier, faster, quicker, less costly, whatever they are. We still seek to still those voices today and ask that you would help us to hear your voice again. Speak to us this morning. Create in us a new and earnest desire to be part of what you're doing. Open our ears and our eyes, and then our hands and our hearts, that we might walk in the ways of the one who taught us to call you Father and to pray to you saying these words that we say together now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and give us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Friends, this is the season of Epiphany. In Jesus Christ, we remember there is light and there is life, and his light is the light of all people. His is a light that shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome. In him, there is nothing in this world or the world to come that can separate us from the love of God. In the name of Jesus, we are forgiven, healed, and set free for a new day. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. children are invited to come forward now. And this version of the story I'm telling today is from the book Read, Wonder, Listen. It's adapted from that. Today I have Samuel here. This is a story about Samuel and about Eli. Now Samuel, he grew up in the house of God. He helped Eli look after the holy place and all its treasures. But Samuel didn't really know God yet. He knew about God because Eli had been telling him all the stories. But knowing with your head is quite different from knowing with your heart. Samuel had never come close to God. But part of the problem was Eli. As the years passed, Eli grew farther and farther away from God. Did he stop listening? Or did God stop talking? Who knows, but in those days, a word from God was very rare. Okay, now this part, Eli and Samuel are going to start talking, so we need to keep our hands to ourselves. Okay, so one night, Eli was asleep, and Samuel was asleep. They were in the place, the holy place in God's house, and Samuel heard a voice calling his name. It must be Eli, he thought to himself, and he ran over to Eli. Eli, here I am. You called me.
It must be a dream. Go back to sleep.
So Samuel went back to sleep. But it happened again.
Samuel, Samuel.
Eli, here I am, here I am. What do you need?
Oh, it wasn't me. Go back to sleep.
So Samuel went back to sleep. A third time it happened.
Samuel, Samuel.
He ran to Eli and said, Samuel, here I am. Eli, it's me, Samuel. It's me. Here I am. And that time, Eli understood.
Samuel, you aren't dreaming. I think God is speaking to you.
Now, Eli was a little jealous that God wasn't speaking to him. And Eli was a little bit worried about what God was going to say to Samuel. But he helped Samuel to be open to whatever God was saying to him. Samuel, go and listen for what God has to say back in your bed. So Samuel went and laid down one last time. And the next time Samuel heard his name,
Samuel, Samuel.
Samuel answered, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. That night, God spoke with young Samuel. God gave Samuel an important message for Eli, though it wasn't a very happy one. Yet with Eli's help, Samuel learned that God is full of surprises for young people and older people. God does new things and says new things. Sometimes it takes fresh ears and new ways to hear the message. It always takes wisdom to understand it, and wisdom comes with age. Samuel grew close to God the more he listened to and spoke with God. He shared God's message for many years to come. I'd like you to pray with me now and repeat the line after me. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
That you surprise us.
That you surprise us.
With how you speak to us today.
With how you speak to us today.
Help us to listen for you.
Help
in the voices of your children,
young and old.
Amen. We go to Sunday school now out these doors here.
Mommy. And as the children go to Sunday school, I invite you to reach for the Psalter, which is the red book that looks like this in the pew. And this morning, as we sing the psalm, we're singing from Psalm 139. We're singing the first six verses and then verses 13 to 18. I don't know what the refrain is. Can someone tell me? One? Okay, refrain one. So we'll be singing refrain one. So what that means is, as you look at the psalm in front of you where there's an R, we sing the first refrain. The refrains are before the psalm. And then when it comes to the psalm, the choir will sing the parts that are not bolded, and we join our voices in the parts that are. And we start by singing, well, Matthew will play the refrain, the choir will sing the refrain, we'll all sing the refrain, and then we'll start singing the psalm. All right? And if you're able to rise, please do so.
Oh,
Good morning. My name is Michael. We'll be reading this morning from 1 Samuel chapter 3, verses 1 to 20, and also from the New Testament, from the book of John, chapter 1, verses 43 to 51. And these are found in the Pew Bible, which is the burgundy book in front of you. And you can follow along as I read. Before we read, let us pray. Thank you, Lord, that you have brought us to this place, to your house. Pray that you might open our ears, that we might hear, and open our eyes, that we might see, and open our hearts, that we might love, and open our hands, that we might serve. In Jesus' name, amen. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. And then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call you. Lie down again." And so he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again, a third time. And when he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." And then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. And therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" And so Samuel went and lay down in his place. And now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." And then the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I'm about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day, I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I'm about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God and he did not restrain them. And therefore I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever." Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called to Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son." And he said, "Here I am." And Eli said, "What was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all that he told you." And so Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. And then he said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. And Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and all the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming towards him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." And Nathanael asked him, "Where did you come to know me?" And Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." And Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." And Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the word of God, upon the Son of Man." Thanks be to God for his word.
There is something about this story of Eli and Samuel that brings back the early days of parenthood for me, when the children would go to bed and then they'd yell, "Mom," and you'd be like, "Go back to bed." You can see how easy it is to just say, "Go back to bed," can't you? It's like, I put you to bed, you have your water, go to sleep. With the children, we thought about the story as Samuel entering into that story through Samuel. As we relive the story now, I invite you to enter the story as Eli. We are going back quite a ways in time when we come to this story. It is more than 3,000 years ago, and we are in the closing days of an era known as the time of the judges. It's an era that had begun when the people of God, newly delivered from slavery and having spent 40 years in the wilderness, had crossed over the River Jordan. They were made up of 12 tribes, each of which carved out some land for themselves. And in the midst of all this settling, they called judges, people appointed by God, who were to arbitrate for the people, help them live well with each other and live well with God, according to the Ten Commandments that they had been given in the wilderness. And as we come to the point in history where Eli and Samuel are in the presence of the ark sleeping that night, things are not going well. The Bible's grim summary of this era is it became a time when everyone did as they pleased. It doesn't take a lot of imagination to see how badly that was going. The temple did not exist yet at this point. The Ark of the Covenant was still housed in a tent. And we hear about the Ark in this story. It's an ornate chest. It contains a number of things that the Israelites have brought with them through their time in the wilderness, including the Ten Commandments. So those were the 10 rules to live by so that one would live well in the presence of God and with each other. It had accompanied God's people on their journey through the wilderness and was now with them in this new land they were inhabiting. Wherever they camped or set up community, a special tent had been set up right in the middle. The ark had been kept there. And with the way it was built, the ark had these angels mounted on top of its cherubim that covered the ark with their wings. And in this way, it represented the throne of the invisible God. The Ark of the Covenant was a visible assurance that God was in the midst of the people. They drew strength from its presence with them. And when their wanderings came to an end and the temple still was a long way off from being built, the Ark of the Covenant had come to rest in a place called Shiloh. Eli and his father before them, him and more recently his sons, because it was a family business, served as priests before the ark. And it was a proud heritage that Eli had. I wonder, as they think of him lying in bed at night, if his mind went back over this whole scenario time and again. If he groaned and wondered to himself in light of this ark that his family was ministering in front of, if he wondered sometimes, oh my goodness, there's the ark, this visible assurance of God, but where is God? Because the word of the Lord was rare in those days, even in Shiloh, even in the presence of the ark itself. People had not heard from God in many a year. Not even the priests. In this era when everyone did as they pleased, even Eli's sons. He must have groaned at times thinking about it. They had cheated people coming to offer sacrifice. They'd lain with prostitutes. Where is God? Why won't God speak? It was a great silence. And I wonder if that's what he thought about sometimes when his days came to an end and he sent the young boy off to sleep. And I wonder what he was thinking that night as he dozed off and suddenly there was a voice saying, "Here I am. You called me." And it wasn't God, it was Samuel. "I didn't call," says Eli, "go back to bed." And he sends Samuel back to Samuel's sleeping area, which is by the ark. And Samuel leaves, and Eli's drifting off to sleep again. And then he hears that, I'm here, you called me. And it's Samuel. And no, says Eli, "I did not call you, lie down. Go back to bed." I'm imposing my own tone of voice on that. I've said these words. The lights had not gone out yet. It is still night. I think Eli wanted some sleep. But distracted by the boy's entrance, I wonder if he is now maybe a bit more awake than he was earlier. Kids can do this, right? And he thinks back, perhaps, over how this boy came to be with him in the shrine at Shiloh in the first place. It was probably 12 or 13 years ago now. A large family had come to the shrine to offer their sacrifices, and he thought they'd all left and gone home when he noticed that the second wife of the husband was still in the shrine, and her lips were moving. He couldn't hear her. She looked distraught, and he thought she was drunk, and he came up to her, and he told her, "This is ridiculous. Put away your wine." "I'm not drunk," she said. She was so upset. I'm praying, I'm asking God for help." And there was so much desire in her voice. Eli had softened and said, "Go in peace then," and he blessed her. "May God grant the petition that you have made to him." She had wanted a child so badly. The first wife had many, she had none. And he hadn't seen the woman again for years. And then one day she had come back with this child, Samuel. The Lord answered my petition, she said. God had given her a son. And she'd promised that if God gave her a son, she would in turn give that child back to God. And that had been her prayer, and God had answered it. And she had brought the boy to the shrine and left him in Eli's care. And maybe it was the way he'd been awoken several times now by this child who was both a gift from God and a gift to God, even in the middle of the night, that Eli began to realize that God, oh, right, God really is acting in this place after all. Samuel himself intruding into Eli's rest is a gift from God and a gift to God. Maybe the boy really did hear someone calling him. Maybe as Samuel slept by the ark, God had talked to the boy. It happened again. Eli heard the boy's footsteps. "Here I am, you called me," said Samuel, and Eli sat up and told him what to do. "Go," he said. "And if the Lord calls you, say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" And as the boy left the room, I wonder what Eli thought then. Could he dare to believe that God was speaking and that a young child could actually hear it? Could he dare to believe that the story of God's saving and blessing presence in the midst of God's people was not over? That Israel might be born again in the midst of this time of chaos. What do you think? The light had not gone out, it says in our reading, and we are in the season of Epiphany. All through Advent, we lit the candles until on Christmas Eve, we not only lit a Christ candle, but used that to light each other's candles. Now, in this season of Epiphany, we are called in the church to focus on what it means to share the light that comes to us in Jesus in all the world. That's why we continue to light a candle, even now in the sanctuary. As the ark was in the shrine, we light a candle to remind us of God's presence, the calling to be light. We enter into that dialogue, perhaps, that Eli and Samuel had. That question that's answered for us time and again down through history. The conviction of faith that not only does God speak to us, but we can hear what God says and act on it. Sometimes we wonder why and how and what. How do we know it's God's voice? And so I return to the experience of Eli with Samuel the next morning when Samuel told Eli what God had said. It was hard news for Eli. His sons had gone astray. His family's ministry at the shrine was over. He looked into the eyes of the boy, telling him this painful truth that even Samuel didn't want to tell Eli. And Eli could see the trueness of it. There must have been a clarity there, an aha. Despite anything he might have wanted or wished or hoped, in that moment, he knew that God had acted and God had spoken. And even though it might have sounded like an end for Eli, the good news was that the story was not over. This was a new beginning for the people of God. And it is announced in the midst of seeming quietness, between an older person whose wisdom is tempered with doubt and a younger person who has yet to learn to recognize all the voices of the world. And in their togetherness, they're both needed to hear this good news. The era of the judges is about to end in this story, and the season of the kings is about to begin. And kings can be good, and kings can be not good. And so before we have kings, we need prophets, ones who will speak God's word into, and God's truth into all the messes and politics they get in, to temper the power that humans have. One who will speak the word that brings us back into understanding what God would have us do. It might mean the end of Eli's line, but it is a whole new beginning of the relationship between God and God's people. The word that comes to me as I read this story and as we think about what it might mean for us as we wonder how we hear God's voice in the world today is discernment, right? Discernment is the awareness, cultivating an awareness that God is at work in and through human life and learning to identify it and respond to it and be part of what God is doing. That's what happens. It happens all through the scriptures, but it happens in such a particular way in this story where you have old and young coming together. No, it takes more than one person. More than one, people bring their experiences to it. Eli's experience, Samuel's experience, the experience of Samuel's mother. They all come together, the stories that have gone before, and it all sits there. And in the evening, there's a stillness. So they lie down to sleep. And God speaks into the stillness. And the next day, when the day is new and Eli rises and Samuel brings him word, Eli has to put away his own hopes and his own dreams and all his own self-interest to receive it. This is discernment. It still works like this. We pay attention as people together to the long history of how we know God has acted among us in the past. It comes to us through the scriptures, through prayer, in our own lives. We can't force God. Because God is God and we're not. But God comes and God speaks. And to hear, we need each other. And we need to take times for stillness. And we need to do what I think you could call stripping or laying aside our own self-interest. We need to pay attention to our own desires and think about whether, you know, that was that whole people doing just what they wanted. Is this leading to life or not? Can I hold my own thoughts and desires and self-interest loosely enough to lay it aside, to enter into dialogue with someone else, confident that through this the Spirit will speak and God made known? Prayer, silence, stillness, not doing all the talking, that's hard. Discernment is everywhere in the scriptures. It is the long practice of the church down through the history of the church, 2,000 years, I'm not talking just the Reformation church, but since the beginning, it's required imagination and reason and turning to scripture and prayer and attending to each other's experiences and the feelings that come forth in ourselves. The yearnings that come forward in each of us and in a group and thinking what we know of God, and does this lead to ways that are life-giving or does it not? And it can't be forced. And it takes time. And it's an invitation into, well, in the Gospel from John, it's an invitation into an alternative way of life to the one the world offers, a way of life that Jesus offers, a life that is full of love and self-giving. It's a life that isn't just about being nice and kind and having good morals. It is a life that often faces the pain and the evil things that are going on in the world, like Eli had to. And it requires stillness. Because when we're anxious, it's really hard to hear God. All our own stuff gets in the way. And exploring and weighing. And sometimes the clarity is really clear, and sometimes we're just walking in faith. Sometimes it's just a light's no bigger than that, and it just shows us the next footstep. But always, whether the light feels small or it's the room is full of it, doesn't go out. And this is what we believe as people of God, that God is still active and part of what's going on in the world. And God still speaks to us, and we can listen and hear and be part of what God's doing. The invitation this week is to think back on your own life experiences, to those moments of clarity, trueness, light, when you've come to see yourself walking in ways that are not of your own devising, but of God's, and then share it. You can share it with me, someone you love, someone you don't know. But this is the season of Epiphany, and this is the good news that the disciples share in John's Gospel, to come and see, to come and see this way of living in the world that is God's. May it be so for you, for me, for the church in God's world. Amen.
Thank you.
In Jesus Christ, God's word became flesh to come and live in relationship with us, to birth God's love in our hearts and God's peace in our world, to bring God's kingdom. As we enter into our time of prayer, when I say, "Your kingdom come," you say, "Thy will be done." And our prayer today will be a bidding prayer. Thy kingdom come. Gracious God, we come this day giving thanks for the Elis, the Samuels, the Hannahs, the Phillips, the Nathaniels, the people of faith who have been part of our life and spoken to us of you and your ways. We give you thanks for the way we have come to know love. And as we pray, God, for this world you love, we pray thy kingdom come. We find, O God, that we look out too often on a world that seems overwhelmed and scarred by violence, a world we sometimes don't understand, a world we are sometimes caught up in, a place where it seems people do as they want without regard to others. We see this in the news. We see this sometimes at home and in work, wrongdoing and hurting. We pray, God, that you might come to the aid of the nations and the leaders, to citizens, to those who are standing in harm's way, to all who sorrow, to those who are sick and wounded, dying or bereaved. So we pray for your protection and for the strengthening of our faith. We pray thy kingdom come. So we give thanks and ponder your invitation to live our lives in you. We pray for courage and encouragement. We know that following you will draw us away from values and expectations of our cultures, our families, our workplaces, that at times we might be asked to protest ways that we have helped create and participate in. So give us courage, Lord, for the temptation to give up and give in can be great. Help us to open our hearts to you and our neighbor, that thy kingdom come. We know following you means walking away from our dependence on things we have accumulated, securities we have placed our trust in, truths about ourselves we cling to. We pray that you will give us the faith to do that. We know we will need it. For as we pray that those who are hungry and poor will be fed and satisfied, those who are ill will be healed, and those who are blind able to see, we ask that you help us to hear and recognize and embrace our own part in seeing that happens. May thy kingdom come. As we go out into your world this week, may your spirit rest upon us. Make us eager to know you, to reach out and share you, to be helping hands and loving hearts in the name of Christ, that thy kingdom may come on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. We are encouraged, friends, to give as God has given to us, and so we bring our offerings and our pledge this morning, not because we want to win God's favor, but because we want to give thanks and praise and be part of what God is doing to bless the world.
Thank you.
And we pray. Holy God, we come remembering that Jesus taught us to love as we have been loved in the flesh. We praise you for those times we have known love in our lives, those moments when we have woken up to the marvelous news of love offered to us and for us, moments when because of this, all things become new again. Praising you for this, we come to you in trust now, offering you these gifts and offering you our very self. We ask that you would bless us and transform us. With ears open to your word, eyes alert to your kingdom, that we and all we have may minister in the name of Jesus and the coming of his kingdom. Amen. In our opening hymn, the question was, who will I send? And we sang, here I am. And here we are, and now we go, for God is sending us out into God's world that we might love as God loves, that you might do this. Go now in the grace of God, with the love of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit. And together we say, Amen.